So far, we've learned what deep learning is, what neural networks are, how they work, some of the common problems that are with neural networks, for example, overfitting or unstable gradients problem, and how to solve these problems and some of the common solutions. We also learned how to set up neural networks initially, right before we start training or tuning. But what happens after we train a network? Of course, we need to evaluate it, and then we need to see how we can make this better. So in this lesson, we will learn how to evaluate, how to diagnose what's wrong with a neural network, and then we learned what kind of steps to take to be able to solve the problem that we see. So there is a kind of like a life cycle to neural networks. So what we do is we first set up an initial model, and then we train this model using the initial settings, and then we test it. And as a result of this training and testing, we have some evaluation metrics calculated. On top of this, what we do is once we have these metrics, we diagnose some of the issues that might be happening, present with the neural network. And on top of that, we make a plan to solve these issues. And then we make improvements based on this plan. And then we train again. And then we test again. And then we diagnose again to see if we have achieved our optimal performance or if we still need to go on the circle and find or look for the optimal solution. So far, we learned how to set up the initial model. We also learned that there is a training and testing section, which is quite simple. We basically fit the data to our neural network. And also we evaluated the neural networks based on some of the metrics according to your problem to see how they performed. But from now on, what we're going to learn in this lesson is how to diagnose what's happening in your model or in your neural network. What is going wrong? And based on that, we're going to make a plan that addresses these problems to see what's going wrong and what can we do about it. And then we'll also see which improvements to make specifically based on what problems we find. So the first thing that we need to know is that it's very good to have one metric when you're comparing your models, because you're going to have different models and you're going to have to see how they perform compared to each other to be able to choose the best one. It could be using different hyperparameter settings or using different architectures and seeing which one fits the problem better. So if you are only using precision, for example, it's quite simple. You're just going to choose the one that has a higher precision, right? So it will be model A. But let's say you are calculating or evaluating these models on precision and recall. So this might be a bit trickier because one model's precision might be higher and the other one's recall might be higher. So in a case like this, it will still be really helpful to have only one metric to be able to compare these models to each other properly. So what you can do, for example, is to use a combination of precision and recall. Of course, you can take an average of them, or you can use something called an F-score. This is practically the average of precision and recall, but is a little bit calculated a little bit differently. So in that case, it will help you to see which one actually is better than the other one based on the F-score. But you might have different issues. For example, let's say you have some models and you are comparing them to each other, but you are calculating different metrics for different age groups. If this model is, I don't know, let's say it's recommending movies and people are rating how good these movies are based on them, based on their preferences. And then you can see for age higher than 50, this is how your model is performing. For ages between 25 and 50, then you can see how it's performing. And for everyone younger than 25, then you can see how it's performing. So it would be very hard to choose a model here because, you know, model A performs the best for people who are younger than 25, but model C performs the best for people who are older than 50. Of course, if you have a really strong preference that you want to definitely target people from age of 25 to 50, then you might go ahead and choose the option B. But what you can do if you want to optimize for all of these groups of people, you can just take the average of these models' accuracies, let's say, and then choose the one that gives you the best average in all of these ages. But there are times sometimes that you cannot only use one metric and you're going to have to use more than one. So one example of that is, let's say you have a model that is predicting something and so you're calculating the accuracy. But at the same time, you're going to use this at a website, let's say, or an app, and the model needs to predict things pretty quickly. Otherwise, the app is going to halt or people are not going to have a great user experience. So what you can do is to say, okay, I'm going to try to find the model that has the maximum accuracy, but at the same time, the testing time, the amount of time it takes the model for to predict something needs to be lower than 100 milliseconds. So then what you can do is to get all of these metrics in front of you and basically say anything that takes more than 100 milliseconds, I'm not even going to consider those. And then I'm going to take the maximum accuracy or the model with the maximum accuracy that also has a test time that is lower than 100 milliseconds. One other example of this could be that you have a self-driving car and you are looking at how accurately it is classifying everything around it, like a child, a bowl, another car, a truck, sidewalk. But at the same time, you don't want, you want as high of an accuracy as possible. You want to classify everything correctly. But at the same time, you don't want to classify things incorrectly in a way that causes or disturbs the car's movement. So let's say every time there's a leaf falling from a tree and during fall time, sometimes your car incorrectly classifies that as something that it will hurt if it hits. So then it does a quick brake. And then what you can do is you want to also minimize the amount of sudden breaks that are unnecessary, right? Then what you can say is, see, okay, I have my accuracy here, but at the same time, I have the amount of false breaks that the car does per hour. So model A, with model A, we have a really high accuracy, but the car does two false breaks every hour. So that might be a little bit too much, right? If there's a rider in the car, you don't want people to constantly have abrupt brakes. That will really hurt the experience with the car. And with other things, maybe you only have 0.2 sudden brakes per hour. That's not a lot. Maybe that's tolerable if it's a false brake. And yeah, then you're going to have to compare using these two metrics. So one of them you can use for optimization and the other one you can use kind of like an elimination technique.